Let's take a look at the scripture reading this morning. If you have a Bible, could you please turn with me to the book of John. The scripture, once again, out of John will be out of first chapter, verses 1 through 18. Chapter 1, verses 1 through 18. Once again, coming out of the book of John. And the title this morning of Brother Howard's message is Thanksgiving Time is All the Time. Okay, so we kind of have a day set aside, right? But he's saying here his title is Thanksgiving Time is All the Time. All right, once again, found in John chapter 1, verses 1 through 18. Everybody find a place this morning? All right. If you could stand with us this morning, we'll read out of John's Gospel this morning. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, and all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, ever to them that believeth on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word was made flesh, and dwelt among us. And we beheld all his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bare witness of him, and cried, saying, This was he of whom I spake, and that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And of his fullness have we all received, and grace for grace. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. No man that hath seen God at any time, the only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. And that is Thanksgiving time is all the time. Found in John chapter 1, verses 1 through 18. Amen. You may be seated. Okay, any unspoken requests? All right, several of those. Brother Howard.
Thank you, Gerald. Appreciate that very much. It's good to see each and every one of you here today. And you're glad to be here, aren't you?
Amen.
Amen. There's a lot of people who like to be in God's house now, but they are not able to, but we're praying that, you know, things will get better, and I know when God steps in all the way, it is going to be different, and I can't say which way it will go. He's going to teach this nation of ours and around the world that He is Lord, and let's just keep praying and keep believing that great things are ahead for us. I know they are, and so may the Lord bless. And if you can stand, we'll go to prayer and just thank the Lord and your request, and we'll be praying for them, and we'll pray one for another. That's what the Bible wants us to do. Our Heavenly Father, thank you again for your kindness and love to us, caring so much, and we realize that on this time of the year when families will be together, and we're thankful, Lord, for what you've done and what you're going to do. We're going to praise your name, Jesus, because you're worthy of the praise. We want to thank you, Lord, for all you've done for us now through many years. And Lord, we ask you to be with these now that are upon our prayer list, that somehow, some way, Lord, that you'll intercede in a special way for each one of these families. And Lord, we think about the one that member of the quartet that went around the United States, and yet there's a boy got beat up this past month and almost killed him, and the Lord, but he's home now. But I just pray, Lord, that you will be with that family today. And we'd be seeing things happen that would never happen before because we respected one another. But guide us now, Lord, in this service. We thank you, Lord, for the ones that have come already to be in your house. You're a great God, and we love you today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Till Jesus comes, we'll work. Till Jesus comes, we'll work. Till Jesus comes, and we'll be gathered home.
Situation in life, but Lord, we pray that their time to come in here to commune with you and the pastor will be that will linger in their hearts forever. And we're going to give you the thanks for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, fellows. We appreciate that so much. God bless you. God bless you. In this envelope, sealed because I've had a bunch of notes, and this is not all of them. I have some of them just didn't run across. But heaven is going to be worth it all. And I'm sharing a little bit as I looked through these yesterday and just seeing what these kids, now they were only about, I'm taking their six, anywhere from 6 years old to 7 or 8. And it was just a joy to work down through people's lives that you just didn't know. And these children that would send you a note, you know, or give you a note and say that I want you to have this because this is the way I feel about it. And so I begin to read some of these again. Now these same people, this is what touched my heart. These same people, when this is written, would now be about 35 to 40 years old. They're not children anymore. And wouldn't it be a joy to be able to meet them? I thought, well, if there's some way I can go back through evangelism and have all the children that whenever I was out there for about 20 years, I thought, man, it'd be wonderful. It hit me. The Lord seemed to think, you're going to get to meet them someday. But some of them stay true to me. And, you know, we can reach people. And we may not reach them in the church as such, but we can reach them. We can reach them for Jesus. And you know, I remember one pastor's son, he was way down there in Kentucky or somewhere. He had to come to church. He didn't want to come to revival, but his dad and mom made him. And he was about 16, I think he hadn't been driving too long, and his clutch went out on his car. And one day I was just there, and I wasn't staying right there, but I had come over there for some reason. And he was just didn't want to talk to me or anything. And I said, "You got a car, son?" He said, "Yes." I said, "But it's not running." And then he got all down in his mouth, and he said, "The clutch is out of it." And I said, "He said I got the money, but I can't get money enough to get anybody to do it." I said, "Well, let me ask you a question, son. Would you be able to get the part you say?" And he said, "Yes." I said, "Well, here's what you need to get." And I said, "I'll be back over tomorrow, and we'll fix that." He said, "We can do that?" I said, "Sure, we can do that." So the boy that didn't want to talk to me, didn't want to say anything because I was a preacher, now, you know, we're laying underneath his car, uncoupling the transmission, pulling it back, and getting the pressure plate and cup off. And clutch out of there, and boy, I could tell he began to talk, and all of a sudden we had it back going. And you know what, I noticed that boy that was on the back there, he moved up in the revival. The next night as the car was running, he was up in the front part here, and he was supporting the revival. So how are we going to face him? Then recognize the children now, because they're going to get to be adults. Here's one that says from Billy. I had another Billy down somewhere, and I had a note from, but it says, "Dear Brother Casteel, how are you doing?" Now, one thing that these letters all had in common, do you have any children? Yeah, I didn't tell them any of them. Some of them are getting up, but they don't come with me no more. They're married or whatever. But I said, yeah, we do. We'll bring them along with you. And this one boy said, "Casteel, that's a good name for you." I said, "How's that?" He said, "Well, it's just Casteel, steel. That's strong. Steel is strong. And that's what I see in you. Somebody is strong, if it was Jesus, whatever." But it's amazing what goes through these children's mind. And some of it they comprehend, and they'll stay with it all the time. It says, "How are you doing? How many revivals have you had? I love you. I've been okay. We moved since you were here." Is doing well. "I'm doing okay. And so is Joan," I don't know who that is. "How is your wife?" And they always want to know about my wife, you know, how is she doing? You know, why is she along? And one of them says, When you come back here again, would you bring your wife with you? And if you can, bring your children with you.
Because they, you know, they could chime in. Let me read just a couple here. I just thank the Lord for this one here. Evidently, they got tired before they got back. It says, "Dear Brother Casteel, you're the BES." They didn't have room to get it on here, so they just stopped right there and then signed it. So, God is so good. I'm going to meet some of these. I know I will. Someday up there, I'm going to meet them. I'm going to read one more to you. Let's pick it up at random. I don't even know. Some of these brought to me just by them, you know. They, get a number out here. There's one here that's got a coin in it, and an envelope. And it said, "This is mine, but I give it to you. I love you." And I still got the envelope sealed. It feels like it's a quarter or half a dollar. I'm not sure what it did, but I imagine it's all they had. One little boy they gave me, I think 6 pennies, said, "Now, Brother Castillo, I just want to tell you that I love you. And this here money that I'm giving you, that's not all I got." He said, "But I'm giving you all you're going to get." So he said, I got some more pennies, but I'm going to keep them. So I'm okay with you doing that. You don't have to give me everything. You know. This year, get the right side. I didn't know that a person could get so nice like you are. Tell your wife that I said hi. One revival, I got saved, and I think it's about time for me to go again. Under pressure heart, you know, they just, I said that because that's the one's got the money in it. Yeah, that almost seemed like it's, I'll open it right here in front of you to see what it is. This is way back there, 30 or 40 years ago. What do you think it is? A quarter or a half a dollar?
Mm-hmm. Pretty heavy.
It is, isn't it? And that's like a half a dollar, isn't it? Is that a half a dollar? That's kind of way back here.
Yes, John, if you can, you half a dollar.
Half a dollar?
Yes, sir.
Half a dollar. That's right. All that time. But anyway. So, you know, these boys and girls, they were sincere. I remember being in Rochester, Minnesota, and Ruth with me up there a couple of times. And I remember that, you know, up at Rochester, they had a party for the children after revival one night. And they were serving ice cream and some soda. And they had some questions, about 8 questions on this piece of paper every one of them got. And it said, if you get all of them right, you get another bowl of ice cream. I imagine the parents read it like that, didn't they? Yeah, but anyway, every one of them missed one, at least. Mm-hmm. And the reason why, they said, which one is 100 years old? I just turned 50, I know that, at that particular revival in Rochester, Minnesota. And they look at me and they say, 100 years old, I can hear them chatting, you know, 100 years, they missed that half of 100, see? But anyway, they missed that one, but not much, it's on my birthday, I know that. And then they went ahead and said, my, that's something else. So which one of them now, and here's one all of them missed, which one of them, their dad was a preacher? Was it Brother Castillo or was it Sister Castillo? And all of them picked me, just because see, their mind went to that level. He's a preacher, so that's why his dad was too. But I told him, no, my dad was a good layman in the church, but he never did preach, you know, to be ordained or whatever. And so they had all missed that. But boy, just the fellowship with all of them, and they had probably 15 or 20 children there coming to, on the revival nights. But anyway, thank you, Gerald. Appreciate that so much. Always good to have a helper in that.
All right. He's a good one, too.
All right. Vic's going to bring us a special.
wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Rescue the souls of men. Counselor, comforter, keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost our way.
That Paul sent down to Timothy. Paul loved Timothy, and Timothy loved him. And that's why I wanted to get these pictures of in your mind of these children. Because around the world, people are hungry for somebody to give them some attention, to thank them for what they're doing. And so I know that if you were in prison, would you desire to send a word of encouragement out to somebody? Or would you send, or would I send a letter out to my best friends and say, you know, I'm not willfully ordered to be here. I'm on one side, not God's side, but I am here because I took up for the Lord. But now here I am. I'm in prison. And Timothy, I want to send you my second letter to you. He sent one of encouragement, and now he's sending another one. He said, prison, this article says prison is the last place from which you expect a letter of encouragement. And that'd be true, wouldn't it? If you were just all, everything going wrong, and you got thrown in jail and maybe beaten and all, would you want to send a word of encouragement? To stay true to God. Don't let the devil take your life and ruin it. Just keep true to God. And so, would that be an encouragement thing that you'd want to tell your best friend about? Serve Jesus. Serve him with all your heart, all your mind. Be thankful for what he's done for you. Would that be a letter that you would send, or I would send, or would I send? I don't know why I'm here. Other people have done more than I've ever done for Jesus. Yet they didn't get beaten or cast into prison, but I'm here. He said, so I want to begin, he said, by assuring you, Timothy, of your constant love and prayer, and remind him of the spiritual inheritance and responsibility. And I don't know where this will all come from, but I know one thing. If we'll minister to the youngest to the oldest in our congregation, then we're going to touch somebody along life's journey. And I don't know why I'm so burdened for our children. I guess it's because so many moms and dads are not going to church anymore. We've reached an hour of a great falling away. There is a great falling away that's coming upon the church world itself. And I believe that we need to be praying, because there are certain parts of the country that are going to rebel against all this that coming to God's house. They believe this is where the healing will start, as people begin to come and just put their faith in God and trust him.
Yes.
And I don't mean now you just come and get around all those who've got, no, I'm not saying that. But I'm saying, fight against the devil. Encourage somebody along life's journey. That's what I'm trying to say. But we are an example to somebody, and we'll never know how great that example is. So let's don't put all of our time and energy into all the big stuff, all the big people. Maybe let's put it in their life and where they're living and what they're going to do. And I said this before, but when I was in Milwaukee and revival, and after the service, after the revival service that night, I said this to you, but I wanted to let you know, I don't know how this boy, how old he'd be. He was about 7, I think, then. But after the revival, his mom and dad was talking to the preacher, and so they were in there for quite a while. Well, I went out in the vestibule area. They didn't have steps like this, but they didn't have, they had a bench out there. And so I went out there just waiting for them, because I rode in with them to the revival. And when I did, I noticed this little boy, about 7 or 8 years old. He came out of the sanctuary. I guess he got tired of listening to them talk. Mm-hmm. And he came out there, and he got right over here on this side. And I had my feet out like that, and had my legs crossed, and I just leaned back in that seat that was out there. And this little lad got right up beside me. And he just crossed his legs, put his arms back, you know, and I'm just looking there. It looked like I'm asleep because I got my eyes closed, you know, when you're leaning back. And this little lad said, you know what, preacher? No, what? He said, God's called me to preach. I said, no kidding. That's wonderful, son. I'm glad to hear that. I mean, give them all the attention, because they need it. God's dealing with people back there. Paul was dealing with Timothy. And anyway, he said, you know what else? And I said, no, what else? He said, God not only called me to be a preacher, but God called me to be an evangelist. Isn't that amazing? Now, here I have been an evangelist, and I'm in there in that church for a week.
God's dealing with him. I'm going to be an evangelist. I said, well, that's good, son. You continue to do that then. And so I crossed my legs, you know, I got more alert for him. And he uncrossed his. And I'll never forget that. Now, that part right now would be probably, he would probably be, that's been about 50 years ago, I guess. Something like that, maybe. So all these children I'm talking about this morning, they're grown-ups now. They either got a place in the church or they've been discouraged out of it, and maybe mom and dad not faithful in any way. So there's a lot of church playing today. Are you listening to me now? Because I want to be firm. I want to be straight. God needs you. If Uncle Sam said, like I said last week, if he's pointing his finger at you and said, I need you, and that was back whenever you didn't have a choice, they drafted you in. And so I remember when I got on the bus over here and rode it to St. Louis and with some other guys, I remember Uncle Sam was pointing his finger and said, I need you. And I'm going to tell you what, back then at 17 years old or so, 18, you had all the energy it needed. And so that's what they worked on. So I said, well, okay, I know you need me, Lord, and I want to do my best. I'm not going to play church. And I'll be at my best for you. And I remember one of my first churches that I had, God began to deal with me. Now, what I'm trying to say is, God will work the miracles in your life. He has the answer if you and I will be obedient. We can't just be obedient when it's something we want.
That's right.
It's something we're going to be challenged to say, okay, Lord, like Paul, I'll go where you want me to go, and if I spend my time in prison over this Thanksgiving, I'm going to do it, but I'm not going to do it by singing sad songs. I'm going to do it by lifting you up, Lord. And so I remember God dealing with me. I got a phone call from a church, and they said, we'd like for you to come and interview at the church, but we would like to maybe give you an invitation to come, and not to be evangelist, but to be a pastor. And I will say this, out of the five churches I pastored, and out of the 20 years I've put in evangelism, I want to let you know one thing. I never went from one to the other without feeling that's in God's will.
Amen.
I know some people say, well, I've been in a burger crawler. When he answered the call to evangelism, he's been in it ever since. And that's wonderful. That's wonderful. But God sometimes has another place for you. You don't understand it, but he has another place. So the DS said, I got this board down here that wants you to come and interview. And he said, but I'm going to tell you one thing. I don't want you down there. I don't want you there. So it doesn't make any difference who's over you. If they're going to go contrary to God, then it's not a good thing. And so I'm not saying go against them, but I'm saying let God work the things out.
Yes.
Well, it came up a little bit later, and I said, well, okay, if you don't want me down here, you know, I'm happy in evangelism, so that's where I'll stay. Well, he said, okay. So he hung up, and it wasn't the next week or the next 2 weeks maybe, somewhere else, and phone rang, and I said, yes. And he said, this is DS, and I've come to tell you, because I have four extensions or five, or I forget now, a lot of extensions into church. And he said, I got a couple of board members or more on the phones. They will not take it that you're not going to come here and interview. And so I'm going to have you to say it plain to these board members that's on these extensions that you do not want to come here. The only thing the DS did not know, after I told him the first time that I did not want to come, I did not do it because God spoke to me. I did not do it because I felt like that, you know, that was not the right thing to do. I do know one thing, after I hung up at first call, during the night sometime I was awakened, and the Lord said, you disappointed me. Now, he could not say that with Paul, because Paul was obedient from the time he was worshiping God. But I did. I said that, and I had flags going up in my life at that particular time when I told him. Now, it seemed like things kind of calmed down, but then he said, now, what I want you to do
I got these board members on the phone, and I want you to tell them you're not interested in coming down here to interview. And I said, well, I'm very sorry. He said, tell them now what you told me, that you don't want to come down here. And I said, I can't do it. I said, because I spent some of the most miserable nights at God speaking to my heart and saying, you grieve me. I got a place I want you to go. Now, for Paul, he was in prison for serving the Lord. So are we ready to go to prison, or do we want to go to some mansion somewhere? Some things we know where everything just fits right where we want it to. So I said, well, I will come down to be interviewed. He said, okay. He didn't like it. He hung up. I didn't get any support the time that I was there. I didn't get no support. I seen the DS and one of the advisory board members out in the parking lot of the church. And I thought, well, they're coming down to visit for a while. But they were only taking pictures of the church. And so he pulled off and left. I was just coming just a few doors in and saying, hi, how you doing, Pastor? But you say, what are you going to do there? You're going to get sired on the church? You're going to get sired on people? No, you can't do that. Paul didn't do it, and it gives us no right to do it. But I went down and met the board, and they accepted me as pastor. And so I spent 3 years, I think, there. But God is good. He is good. And Paul said here, in his letter to Timothy, he said, Timothy, be a good soldier. You won't stay in the armed forces at all. Victoria knows that. She was in there for a while, and so was Jamie and some of you. But I know one thing. If you're a good soldier, you're going to be moved up. That's all there is to it. If you're not, then you're going to have to answer to your sergeant or whoever. But I listened to what Paul was saying, and he said, I begin to assure you, Timothy, you're my son in the Lord, that you keep the faith. Keep your prayer life up. He's encouraging what to do. And I believe if there's ever a day when the church needs a rally, and we need to get this closed mouth that we got towards God and what we know He's talking to us about, and just do it. Just do it. We'll never regret it, because God will reward us. He went on to say, Paul warned Timothy that his teaching will come under attack as men desert the faith for itching ears. And people do not want to hear, if you sin, you're going to go to hell. That's just all there is to it. I know some say, well, I'm not too bad a person. I'll be able to say in my last days and last hour, I'm sorry, Lord, and I'll go with you in. Watch out, because the devil will be more powerful then than he is in your life now. Because he's not going to get you to make that decision, and you want me to make a decision. So Paul said, you keep the faith, Timothy. You keep your eyes on the Lord. In Paul's last epistle to Timothy, in letter to Timothy, when Paul's epistle was collected together, was probably added in his letter to Timothy when he wrote, Timothy, keep the faith. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Don't let the world get you crowded out. Just because somebody else in the church used to be on fire for the Lord. I mean, you could almost see feel the heat from the Holy Spirit upon their lives. Don't let that be your guide. Don't let that be your decision maker. You put your eyes on Jesus and you serve Him with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And do it with all your heart. And I honestly say that I want to be faithful to Him and do what He wants me to do. So if you was writing an epistle today from prison for serving the Lord, a prison, he didn't rob a bank or anything like that. He was just serving the Lord, and the world did not like it. And so they put him in there. So Thanksgiving is a wonderful season. And I pray that you will, and I will make the best of it by encouraging people, keep your eyes on Jesus. Don't let the devil get you sidetracked. and gets you discouraged or defeated in such a day as this, let take a good look at God's goodness to us. And I want to look at some things that right now, and that you can take to Thanksgiving every day of your life. It doesn't have to be just this one day on Thursday. It can be every day of your life. It can be every day of my life. I can be thankful. Thankful for what, preacher? If I was in prison or I'm getting sick and everything's just going wrong, my marriage is about to go shipwreck and everything else, come on, preacher, preach to me. Tell me what I need to do. Well, it says in God's Word in John 1, and from this one chapter, to verse 18, we need to be thankful for God's saving grace. And we could talk about that all the time. We don't have to wait till Thanksgiving Day to be thankful for our redemption, for the plan of salvation that was ushered for us.
Yes.
We could say that all every day of our life from here on into eternity.
Amen.
Jesus, thank you for caring so much for me. It's Thanksgiving season, and I believe we need to be able. Now, you remember when Zacchaeus, was up in that tree and Jesus was making his way, and Zacchaeus was a small fellow and he climbed up in the sycamore tree, and they said, what are you doing up there, Zacchaeus? He said, I want the Lord to see. The devil's going to try to blind you from God. He's going to try to blind you from doing for what the Lord wants you to do. And I'm thinking that, this is the day that we ought to take. And I see that in verse 17 in John, Gerald read. And of his fullness have all we received. That grace for grace. It's love for love. And so, do you love Jesus today for what you're thankful for, that you know beyond any shadow of a doubt that your salvation is as real today as it was when you gave your heart to the Lord? Now, don't tell me you can be doing everything. Don't tell me you can desert the church. Now, I'm not talking about this sickness now. But you just don't have a desire. You don't have a will. You know what I'm thinking? I'm thinking that we need to get some things out in the open that we are not out with anymore. And you say, well, where's the fire at in the church? The fire is in you. The fire is in me. And if that fire is going out, or if it's gone out, then we're not going to be good for anybody. But if that fire is burning, and this is what I'm talking about today, we ought to be thankful for the privilege of coming to church.
Amen.
This is God's house.
Yes, amen.
It's God's house. And let's don't give up on it. Let's just keep our eyes on Jesus. And may it be that with big grace upon grace. As far as praying in the home at night, Ruth and I, we prayed for our kids every night. But if we weren't involved in family altar, then it wouldn't happen. And so where's the shipwreck then coming, Pastor? It's coming out of our families, out of our homes. The mother and dad don't pray together. They don't, I used to have a bumper license plate on my car. And I remember coming home to church one night up the city, and cop pulled me over and said, you kind of cut that guy off there when you made that left-hand turn. And I said, well, I'm sorry about that. I thought I had plenty of time, but I didn't want to debate the issue. He walked around my car. I'll never forget. He got on the front and where that license plate. Family said, pray together, stay together. And he stood there in front of my car and read that. And he come back to me and he said, and the three children were in the back seat of my car and Ruth was over there. And he said, the officer said, been to church? Yes. Here's that sign saying, families that pray together, stay together. You can't get out and pray and talk to God. You pray, your children learn, pray for your husband. Pray that God will continue to strengthen him and help him to be the right husband, but be the right father to the children. God can do that. Same way with the wife. When she gets her time to pray, pray for your husband. Husband, pray for your wife. You cannot be a phony and get down there and pray for one another and then go out and beat one another up or talk bad about one another. It won't happen. It won't happen. It'll turn your whole life around, turn my life around. And so that's what I want. Be thankful for saving grace, because it's the most wonderful thing
yes, amen.
That can happen to any of our lives. So we can do that any time of the year. Amen. Be thankful for that. Oh, hey, what are you saying, preacher? I'm saying that we ought to be thankful enough that we want our homes to be what God wants them to be.
Yes.
Don't get so tied up in this world and all its goodies that we forget about God and about bringing God into our home each day of our life. So think about that. But one thing about it, it's one thing to be saved, it's another thing to be sanctified holy. In other words, it's another thing to be surrendered totally to God. Can't ride the fence. I've heard that all my life. You either be on one side or the other side. Don't blame the county you live in or the city you live in, or don't blame somebody else for all your problems. Own up with God. Talk to God about it. Let him give you the answer. What the answer would be for your situation. But I know one thing that I love God for every day, and I worship this thankfulness of him, is that when I was saved by his blood and I surrendered all a couple of months later to the Lord. I mean, I totally surrendered all. You say you can be saved and not have it all surrendered to him? Exactly. Because God's going to begin to speak. He's the owner of your life and my life. He's going to be able to speak about different things. You're going to start going to church. You're going to start being faithful. You're going to start teaching. You're going to start singing. Do this all for the glory of the Lord. Don't do it as a fun thing. Do it for somebody that needs the Lord will come to that wonderful saving. And so what I wanted to say this, after we're saved and after we're cleansed, this old carnal nature is cleansed out. It makes a difference in our life. It makes a difference. And I'm going to tell you what, there's a lot of church people, if they don't go on and surrender it all and let God come in and cleanse the inside, he said, he won't be there very long because the devil is going to have power. But once we receive the Holy Spirit and he comes and lives within our life and we have a desire to live for him every day and put him first, not last, but first, then we're going to see great things begin to happen in our life. And I know that whenever I went out to Bible college out of Colorado Springs, I know the old devil said, you'll never do that. You'll never leave the trucking industry after 15 years of seniority. You're about 6 men off the top. So you're not going to be going out to no Bible college. But what the devil didn't know, I was totally surrendered to the Lord. And whatever the Lord wanted, that's what I wanted. Because I knew I could not be effective in the ministry without the Holy Spirit having full control of my life. And so Ruth and I, we desired to be about God's business. And so we wound up, and we did leave the company. Went out to Colorado Springs, and on the way down, the old devil got in my car out there. And he said, now, you signed your last paycheck. You sold your best car. You've done all of this. That's foolish stuff. You don't need to do all that. You don't need to sell out to God. Yes, you do. If you don't, this world is going to get so troubled, it's going to deceive you. It's going to deceive me. But if we are fully surrendered to him, the devil has to fight through God. That's all there is to it. Because we're not our own. We've been bought with a price.
That's right.
And I want to be faithful every day of my life. I remember going out there, the old devil said, now where are you going? He acts so dumb sometimes to be so smart because he's got some of the most educated people in the world living for him. They're serving him and it's growing. His number's growing. I'm going to tell you that because there's a great falling away. That's what the word said had happened. And got out there that night and that's when the old devil got in my car. He got in between me and Ruth. And he said, now where are you going? You say, oh, the devil don't talk to you that way. Get on fire for God. And watch for this. Get on fire for God. Do what God wants you to do or I want to do. And I'm going to tell you what, you'll sense the power of the enemy too, coming in like a flood in your life, trying to disturb you. I said, I'm going to Nazarene Bible College. What are you going there for? I said, I want to go there because I want to be a better servant of the Lord. I want to be a better servant of the Lord. And so I want to learn. You say, well, I thought you was already in the work and I was, but now I want to do what God wants me to do, and so I'm going to Bible. So he began to laugh, and it got to be about midnight, and we were traveling on a long hill, and that car that I had wasn't the best, and it was slowed down pretty good going up one of the big hills out there, and the old devil began to laugh at me. He said, now you're just a fool, is where you are. You're just a fool. You left your best job. You signed your last paycheck. You don't even have a place to go to when you get out there. We went out there a couple months earlier and kind of looked it over, and we felt surely it's where God wants us. And you know, I never will forget, he said, you don't even have a house to go to. And the devil knew this, because when we got there, the people said, you can come and stay with us the first night until you find your apartment or something. And we didn't sell our house yet, because we had another person, Don Wells, that lived here. I mean, preached here a few times. He, yes, but anyway, trying to get sold that old one. But I never will forget, I had enough of Satan in my car. He rode long enough. And I'm going to tell you, you're not powerful enough, and I'm not either, to push Satan out. He's strong. He's powerful. You've got to have the Holy Spirit living in your life, and you've got to rebuke him in the name of Jesus. It won't be because you're the best person in church, or you give the most, or whatever. It won't work that way. It don't work that way. I tell you what, I got over there by faith, and I got a hold of that door handle. I got my foot up, and I kicked him out. I said, devil, you've been riding me long enough. Get out of here. Have you ever done that lately? I mean, when the devil's saying, well, you know, this is not right, this is not right, this is not, well, then what are we doing there? What are we doing to change it? Are we preaching like God wants us to? Are we singing like God wants me to? Are we teaching like God wants? Something's happened, yes, something's happened. And he said, what will start is the great falling away with our churches. Great falling away. People become lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. Wow. Well, I'm so glad that I can be thankful today for his keeping grace. Because I got saved, Ruth and I went down to the altar the first day, and we got saved when we was in our early 20s. We've been living out there in the world and doing the things and had no desire about church or anything else. But you know, they were in an old-fashioned revival at Northside Church in Nazarene. God works in mysterious ways. God spoke to me. When I was getting into my little son just able to get on his feet, and I had a can of beer in my hand, and I started to tip it up to his him, because he was reaching out, didn't know what he was reaching out for. That's up my responsibility. And I was about ready to tip it to his lip, and all of a sudden, I heard this voice. It said, where are you leading your children? And Mom and Dad, I may be talking to you today, I don't know. And where are you really leading your children? Are you taking control? Are you really loving the Lord with all your heart? Does the children know that? Or do they think you're really going down to that building down there, and that's all there is to it? Well, I know one thing. When Gary reached out for that, and that voice spoke to me, I was in an old upstairs apartment up there in St. Louis. We were. And I got up from there, because I felt the convicting power. I didn't know there was an old-fashioned revival going on, and I didn't know that's where my brother was singing up there as a song evangelist, and Arlene played the piano. But I know one thing, something happened to me. I got a longing to go to church for the first time. So I called Junior and asked him, I said, where is that church at located you go to down there? He said, well, we're not down there this week. I'm singing in a revival up at Northside. He said, won't you come up there? I said, we will. I'm going to tell you, don't underestimate when you pray and when you believe that God's got keeping power for you, that you're going to influence somebody that you're praying for. You're going to influence them. And eventually, they want the same Jesus that you got. So I've got to close. But I know one thing. I went into the kitchen and I said, Ruth, how would you like to go to church tomorrow? And to my surprise, because she had made the statement so much, I want to marry a truck driver, and I'm not going to be married to no preacher. I'm going to tell you that. Her dad preached 38 years in the Church of Nazarene, and he said, I'm not going to be. I've seen my dad mistreated so much by misunderstandings and stuff. So I'm not going back in that parsonage again. And I heard it plain. But you know what? I knew the Lord was able to supply all my needs. And I knew that he spoke to me. And I knew that I went to the altar that Sunday morning in Oberlin, and I said, Lord, I'll do what you want me to do. And so the next morning I went up to talk to my pastor, and he encouraged me to get involved in doing more. And so I did. And you know what? We went up there that Sunday morning, and oh, here it is. My brother up there singing, you know how you sing, and in our old fashioned revival, we've been going on 3 or 4 nights, and wow. And the preacher got up and preached, and fire began to just dance all over the place, so to speak. And oh, when they gave the altar call, I thought I was never going to give the altar call. I didn't have to have nobody come back here and pull me down to the altar. I know I've heard so much fun made of people beating them in the back till they almost beat them to death, you know, saying, get it all, get it in, get it real good. And you know what? I stepped out on my own. And I went to the altar for his keeping power. So I believe with all my heart, when we give our hearts to the Lord that day, Ruth tells me quite often I had to do some house cleaning. And I don't mean, you know, dirt, because she wasn't a dirty person. But she had things that, you know, magazines sometimes are not fit for a good Christian home. They may start out good, and then they get into some filth and stuff. So anything that's got an edge of filth on it, get rid of it. Don't keep it in your keeping to irritate and entice you to go back and look at that article again, because it's got a lot of truth in it. So, God will provide for your future and my future if we'll put our trust in Him. Are you willing to do that today? Be thankful for Him. I'm going to cut across here. I want to read this song. When upon life's billow, when they race and roar, and I am tempted and tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your blessings. Count them one by one to see how great the things God has already done. I like that. That's a good song. Count your blessings, name them one by one. See what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. See what God has done. The last verse says, so mid the conflict, whether great or small, do not become discouraged. God is over all. Count your blessings. Blessings the angels will attend. Count and comfort you and your journey until your journey's end. So He's not going to leave us. He's not going to forsake us. Count your blessings. And I want to ask you, are you thankful for this time of the season? You're thankful because your family's coming in? You're thankful for this and that? I'm thankful for all that. But that's not what I really want. I want the children to see again that their dad is living a godly life in a wicked world. It is a wicked world. A lot of preachers are going down the drain. They're just going down the drain. They're giving up on their preaching ministries, and they're going down and getting involved in things that they thought they'd never do. Wesley, my beloved friend, was a member of my church, and I've said this before. And Wesley didn't have it in his heart. He had it in his brain. I've given the all to the Lord. I've given them. But Pat came to me one day, and she said, Pastor, I want to tell you about Wesley. Wesley's not the same man at home as he is talking down here at church. Now, I've never been a Christian. I don't even know what it's like. But I know one thing. I know that's not Christianity, what he's doing. He gets mad. In fact, Pastor, when he left the house this morning, when we just built a new one, he get it all built, we moved into the home, but he said, Wesley got mad at something we got involved in the house there, and he kicked the kerosene stove and spilled that fluid all over the carpet and stuff. He said, I know that you know where Pat's at. You won't tell me where she's at. I said, I do not know Wesley. Well, he's a smart man. So he said, I'll tell you what you do then. She'll be calling you. I know she'll call you. And when she calls you, you get that number down, will you? And I'm going to be back to see you, you know, with me. If she'd brought some stuff over there, and she said, he'll burn the house down is what he'll do before it's all over with.
But she said, I stepped out on a little balcony we had made, and I looked down at Wesley, and I said, Wesley, he just raised his foot up and kicked a big dent in the door of the truck. And he said, I said, Wesley, you can't change yourself. You can yield it to God and he can change you, but you can't change yourself. You can't speak to a leper and say your spots go away and they go away. God has to be involved in that. But she said, Wesley, I love you, but I can't take it no more. Will you change? Will you come home tonight? Will you change? He didn't say, I will. I'll try. Wesley just got in that truck and he threw gravel all down the driveway and he went off in the distance. Preacher, you can do something for me. I'm going to tell you what. Preachers can do something, but don't blame them, friend. You've got a decision to make. You have to be the lady or the man of the house or the church. You can't let somebody else do all you're doing for you. And one day, after about 2 months, Wesley came to church. He knelt to the altar. When I first met him, they were living out of wedlock. People today said, I just moved in with him. Oh, okay, you just moved in with him. Well, do you have the same bedroom? You can cut it in half. You have the same bedroom? Do you sleep together? Sure. Well, that's part of it. We can't pay two rents, so we... Yeah, sure. Hey, that's living out of wedlock. That's living in sin. Are you hearing me today? Preachers won't preach it because half of their membership now is living in sin. You can't have the power of God and the glory of God and live in sin. You can't do it. I can't do it either.
That's right.
We're living good. But don't get your mind in the gutter, preacher. Don't get your mind. Get it out of the gutter. Yeah, I got it in the gutter. What are you doing? Where's your image? Where's your influence on your children or on your neighbor or if somebody had faith in you and thought they'd just start coming to church? But now you're living out of wedlock. You're living in sin. Name it the way it is. It's sin. Neither are we going to repent of it and get out of that mess and let God begin to help us. Or we're going to go deeper. And one day, Pat called me. And she said, they're having a family reunion. And I got this call from Wesley. And I'd like to let you know that I'm going to come and we're going to go to the family reunion together. And do you know, I got another call from Wesley, and he said, Pastor, I wasn't his pastor at this time, he'd already moved. He said, Pat and I are back together. We got all our differences worked out. We're gonna be what God wants to do. Because see, Wesley came back to the altar where this all happened. And I remember seeing a big guy down to the altar, and he was just, tears were just running off of his face. He said, I'm so sorry, Lord. I need your help. See, you need your help. You got to get to the place. Wow. God did to him.
Amen.
When Pat called me, she said, how's Wesley doing? I said, now, Pat, let me get right to the point. Are you talking about the old Wesley that you left here a few months ago? Well, I'm going to tell you, the old Wesley's not alive anymore. He's dead. He's dead to transgressions and sin. I'm going to tell you what. Wesley came to the altar, and he begged God to forgive him, and I believe he was sincere. So there's a new Wesley here, lives here yet. Is that who you're talking about? I'm not pretty sure I'm not talking about Wesley. And I think this was an encourager to come, and so they went together, and they've been together. He'd been down and said, Southport, and we've been pastoring for quite a long time. When I first met them now, they lived in out of wedlock. Mm. They had a son that was about 18 years old that lived out of wedlock. And Wesley preached me two fiery messages because his dad was a Wesleyan pastor. And he preached me two fiery messages that, you know, and the Lord said to me while he was preaching them, he said, if you get out of here and you don't talk to him about what, I'm going to hold him at your charge. Maybe that's what God needs to tell some of us. I'm going to hold some of these things at your account. You're teaching in Sunday school, or you're singing or preaching behind the pulpit. I'm preaching myself too. I'm going to hold this at your charge if you're not faithful to what you're supposed to be doing. And my, I will forget. It all began to come together. And Pat and Wesley, they became faithful servants to the last I ever heard of them. And they'd been down there for about 16, 17 years, pastoring at one church. But he said, my dad was a Wesleyan pastor. On the way home, when God spoke to me, I didn't speak much to Bob about that. He said, well, it met him out on his job. I said, I don't know how old is your charge? So before we got out on the porch, I said, Wesley, I want to talk to you about something. You and Pat are living in sin. And you preached me two messages. One of them was on hell tonight. And the other one, you know, he had his dad's memory, and he talked about what his dad did. And he was going to try to get into heaven like that? It's not going to happen. You're not going to get into heaven by holding on to mom or dad's salvation. You're going to have to work it out in your own life.
Amen.
That's right.
And so I said, Wesley, I'm talking to you. I'm telling you, you need to get your life in order. Pat says she don't know the difference. She lived in sin all of her life. She never went to church. But you did. So somebody can be held accountable. And that's when Wesley got it all right with God. And I have so much to be thankful for today. Could we stand? Is there someone this morning said, you know, Pastor, don't talk to me about sin. I just want to be a person having itching ears. Just talk to me about little fancy stuff. That's all I want. I don't want you to be preaching the Bible to me. Well, don't come to church then. Because your blood is going to be on my hands if I'm a minister of the gospel and I don't preach the truth.
That's right.
Now, Paul preached the truth, and he was in prison, but he preached the truth. Timothy, I want to tell you, keep the faith. Keep your faith. Keep your eyes on Jesus, is what he's saying, Timothy. Right. He said, as he's helped me, he'll help you. I encourage you, Timothy. So I encourage you this morning. If you have a need, would.
Spirit of light, who has shown us